Merhabalar. Thank you so much, Michael, for coming.
Sure, thank you.
As my co-anchor over there, Junaid, mentioned, we're going to talk about the 10 years and the whole story behind it. But I love your article that you put in Wall Street Journal's online version, Market Watch, why you should worry about a 1987-style crash. Are we heading towards that way? Are we going to see a crash?
Well, you know, I do think there are very significant parallels to what happened in 1987. Interest rates are the key to everything in a capitalist economy. They set everything else around interest rates. Now, when interest rates move gradually, it tends to be indicative, it tends to be a sign of rising growth, rising inflation expectations. However, if they move sharply in a very sudden way up, it tends to actually be a shock to the economy. It happened in the 70s, and it happened right before the 1987 crash, whereby yields back then were rising very substantially as the Dow itself was advancing very substantially.
Like it happened to us.
Like, which is
Tuesday.
Really been, right, which has been especially the story of the last, let's say, 3 months. And this whole year,
that's
in
right.
general, the Dow has been rising.
But July we're seeing, rally.
Right, and we're seeing this entire spike in yields because of this fear about tapering. The problem is, by using the word taper, which is what the Federal Reserve has put out there, it's causing a scare in the bond market. A scare in the bond market might scare the stock market. Why? Because rising rates will impact housing, will impact automobiles, will impact anything that's growth sensitive, and will dramatically alter the direction of reflation, which is everything the central bank wants to achieve. Now, if the Dow and the S&P are getting concerned about this, they may start to fall aggressively to warn the Fed, don't pull back.
It, yes. And you talked to Mark Faber, right?
Mm-hmm.
Gloom, boom, doom report. Gloom, boom, doom report. And you wrote also for him as well, right? And then you would brought him how similar 2013 has been to 1987 on the CNBC the day before.
Right.
What is it that really, you know, he's also putting in that report? And you, I know you're talking about the fear and the bond market. And are we going to see a very steep decline within the next 2 months, or what is your target, let's say, for the year end?
I mean, it very much depends on what the Fed's going to do in September as we near this.
But do you expect Fed to really taper, and is it going to be an aggressive taper?
Yeah, no. So this is, I think, the real difference between now and 1987. So we talked about the similarities. The difference between now and 87 is paranoia.
Paranoia.
Meaning that I am sure that Bernanke and other Fed officials are also aware that if the stock market begins to crater and go down hard, it will impact the wealth effect, which is this idea that rising asset values will make people spend more, which will then filter through to the economy. If the stock market then falls, it becomes a poverty effect. The central bank, I think, is aware of that. So unlike 87, where that wasn't the main focus of the Fed, now it is. So that might counter a bigger real collapse. But in the case of, you know, the piece I'm going to write about for Faber, it's really about disconnects. So how crashes occur historically is through these prolonged periods where something is out of sync. Out of sync meaning, as an example, this year, emerging markets relative to the S&P, massively out of sync.
Emerging markets relative to the S&P. Yeah, I was going to ask that too.
So, right.
So they're out of sync.
Out of meaning that they have not participated at all on the upside with the U.S. market. They're
the
down.
Correlation, can we say, has been broken.
Right, in a very unusual way. Now, that spread is the widest it's been since 1998. Mm. In 1998, there was an event, the Russian default crisis.
Right.
But you have no event this time around, so why is the spread that large? That's a disconnect. How do you resolve a disconnect? You could have the U.S. stock market fall aggressively to resync down to the emerging markets, or you could have emerging markets resync up, or a combination. But if the bond market continues to do what it's doing, U.S. stock market actually probably likely falls, and emerging markets might actually stay somewhat stable.
But
because
the bond market
already quite a bit.
The market has lost $67 billion bond market yesterday as opposed to 29 the previous. So it is doing.
The bond market has done tapering already.
The foreign selling.
Right. But the thing is, you know, once the cat's out of the bag, so to speak, once people begin to be afraid of negative momentum, losing value, you end up having more and more selling than the Fed is buying.
Does the economic data support Fed's tapering possibility?
The thing is,
are you happy with the economic data?
All the economic data is a lagged response to low rates from the past 6 to 12 months. right? Interest rates act with a lag. So
that's right.
They've been responding to that over the last 6 to 12 months of low rates. Now we're entering a period where rates have risen substantially. Home builder stocks, financials,
CPI.
Consumer discretionary, everything is weakening. So it seems like best for the future, economic activity might actually be dampening.
But some of them are coming better. So are you talking like Lockhart, who says it's uneven?
Well, yeah, no, I do think it is in many ways uneven because you have domestic versus global industrials acting very differently. But what I'm suggesting is that because interest rates are spiking now, we don't know if the economy can handle it until after the fact.
After the fact, right. Even though the economic data somehow...
Because it's reacting off of an older story, now we have a new story with this rising rate environment.
You're talking about collapse, crash. These are strong words and very, very negative. They are causing fear as well, not from you, from many other people as well. Like George Soros, yesterday we figured out in one of the articles that he had a put on SPY, meaning he's extremely bearish for S&P 500. He increased his position in the put, in the sell, from 149 to almost 5% within the last quarter. And everyone is selling the gold here and there. But on the other hand, Carl Icahn is buying Apple. The other activist investors are acting weird. What is this whole investors, activist investors, billionaires doing? Maybe stir the market, I guess I can say.
Yeah, I mean, in the case of Soros, he might be doing it as a hedge to counter. So as an example, going back to emerging markets versus the U.S., that spread, you can trade it by going short the S&P and long emerging
short
markets.
Short the S&P, long the emerging which markets, which is also good for Turkey as well,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's a broader theme. I think in this case, it's really the BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, which have
BRICS,
lagged the most.
BRICS, yeah. Turkey's not in there, but it's still in that emerging market category.
Right. In the case of someone like Carl Icahn, he's obviously has a very different time frame. So time frame matters. What I'm suggesting here, I'm not saying there's absolutely guarantee going to be a crash. Of course not. What I'm suggesting
simply...
But
George Soros is kind of going there. And remember his 1992 bet.
Right. The future is purely about probability. So what I'm simply suggesting is that the more the bond market behaves this way, the probability increases much more than most realize of some kind of a break in stocks to scare the Fed into keeping stimulus in place.
Do you think Bernanke would do it, though?
I think it depends on how
stocks
act.
Would he be scared?
Yeah, no, I think so. And I think it depends on how stocks act between now and the actual... announcement, right? If the Dow suddenly goes down 10% between now and the announcement, I'm fairly certain they will keep stimulus in place even longer than most people.
So it might not happen in September FOMC meeting.
If the Dow falls enough.
Enough, and it's been falling. And also, Michael, your mutual fund, your ATAC model, mm-hmm. has been outperforming. So where should the investor put his money? Stocks, bonds, commodities, they're all acting a little out of line.
Yeah, no, it's a challenging
what
environment.
What do we do?
That's a challenging environment. For us, we've been very recently playing the emerging market catch up against the U.S. very recently.
You've been investing more in emerging markets?
The last few weeks. Now,
last few weeks.
Having said that, we have a buy and rotate strategy. So what that
buy
means
buy and rotate, right, yes.
Rather than buy and hold. So that means that we could very easily, it may happen sooner than later, get fully out of the emerging markets and get very defensive. This is a very, I think, fragile juncture. On the one hand, the emerging market trade can be a big trade. I've been calling it the fat pitch, whereby it does catch up to the U.S.
I like the way Fed pitch. I'm repeating because I'm making slow. Fed pitch. So it might.
It might. But on the other hand, what will throw that off is if you have a very big decline because stocks in general are afraid of what's going to happen in the bond market. So you have these two countering kind of forces. You have this mean reversion you can play, but at the same time, you have the potential for some kind of a breakdown. So for us, we may rotate very defensively. It might be one of those junctures where it makes sense for an investor as opposed to a trader to simply step away for a little bit, be careful, because there are so many things that can change the direction of these disconnects in just the next 4 weeks that it may not be worth swinging until you have a real clear thing to swing at.
You do the rotation every week.
Essentially.
But for a long-term investor, looking at this market, where would you put your money in?
If I had a crystal ball for something that far out.
Markets, let's say. Equity markets, commodities, bond markets.
I think it's the short-term is much more observable than the long-term. There are studies that show, for example, that weathermen tend to be much more accurate in the next 2-3 days than the next 7.
So I like the way you put storms and weathers. So you're talking about the weathermen, yes?
Conditions matter. So my point is that I don't presume to know what's going to happen 2, 3, 4 years from now because I think there's too many things that can happen. But in the very near term, if you are looking to be an investor, you might be better off simply waiting. The biggest problem that most investors have is they get shaken out because of volatility. They get scared when they see
and the VIX volatility
has been very low, and that also leaves it susceptible to some kind of a move higher. And but my point is that investors tend to be scared by volatility, so maybe wait until we've actually seen some volatility to start getting back in, at least on the equity side. And if we get past this, I think emerging markets will likely be the next leader.
I never seen you. You're always positive about the stock markets. If we pass it, collapse, crash, I never seen you this negative, actually, about equity markets. Also, you talk about the broader U.S. beta is failing to see this is an issue presently. Can you explain a little further into this, the beta, because it's an important indicator right now.
Right. So, you know, everything in markets act with a lag. So, in other words, you tend to have markets efficient internally, not so efficient externally. So bonds react in a certain way. Stocks do not necessarily react at the same time.
That's right.
With a lag. So there are structural reasons for why these lags occur. What I'm suggesting is that if the bond market keeps doing what it's doing, the stock market with a lag will begin to be afraid of what the bond market is doing. This is what happened in 87. This is also what happened in 2011. In 2011,
the crash, right, but that was more like a technical.
It was partially technical, so-called. But it was a similar disconnect. In 2011, you had yields falling, deflation expectations rising, and then you had the sudden realization through the stock market falling hard in August, the summer crash of 2011. This time around, it's not exactly the same type of setup, except in that spiking yields can be deflationary. Mm. You tend to have these breakdowns in beta when you are in a deflationary juncture.
We have two scenarios, right? You created here as well. So if the bad scenario holds, do you see the S&P 500 going down 1,500 by the year end?
Oh, I think it's very possible, yeah.
What is your estimate?
The thing is, it's unclear because it depends on what the Fed is going to do next.
Morgan Stanley says 1,900 with the good scenario, with the bear scenario. Bullish scenario. What do you think?
I'm not a believer in targets as much as conditions. What I'm simply suggesting is that the conditions right now are somewhat fragile.
But the conditions are not only the rising yields. It's not only the earnings disappointment. It's also the geopolitical concerns.
Yeah, and that's true, right? And I do think that's also an exogenous, what could be an exogenous shock maybe in the waiting, as much as everyone has argued that about the Middle East, but with everything going on in Egypt especially, if oil begins to also skyrocket because of concerns of some kind of supply disruptions, we've seen what spiking oil does. Also.
Oil spiked yesterday, right, but all the commodities.
All the commodities, right. So, if oil were to, in an exogenous, second, third variable way, start moving very aggressively up, combined with this issue about tapering. It's a very nasty combination, I think.
Everything comes and turns around tapering, doesn't it? How about gold, though?
I think this is perhaps the one area which I think might indicate the Fed will not step away from stimulus just yet.
Will not step away. Right. Gold is an indicator?
Yeah. So,
how?
So gold tends to do well in what's called a negative real rate environment. Negative real rate environments are environments where inflation is higher than the interest rate.
Yes. Yeah.
And historically, that's when you get momentum. Gold fell aggressively as we entered a positive real rate environment, as yields rose.
Yes.
Now, if gold is starting to outperform, it may be an indication of bets that we will return to a negative real rate environment. How do you get back to a negative real rate environment? With the Fed putting more stimulus.
Is that why everyone is throwing their gold away, like Buffett yesterday and Paulson today?
Yeah, well, I mean, their arguments about the physical versus the...
Versus
what's in the financial markets. I think in the case of gold, it's reacted to what everything else has reacted off of, which is this deflationary shock of a sudden positive real yield environment. It's not just gold. I mean, a lot of the commodities did very poorly this year in 2013 alongside the emerging markets. I mean, it's in many ways the same trade. Gold just got the brunt of the hit. But if gold were to continue to outperform, I think that's indicative of some kind of feeling the Fed is not going to step away. That, by the way, could then counter any kind of a crash collapse scenario.
Is the economy strong to withstand? For example, the retail sales came really nice, right? Yeah. There are also housing sectors that's improving, in a way, we can say, except for the pending,
right.
Gave us a little mixed signals. And the CPI is somewhat in line yesterday's numbers.
Still relatively low.
Still low, not up 2% yet. And did you see the unemployment yesterday, 6 years low?
Right.
Does that give us any indication that he will really, really taper? Because you say that he might stop. But are they going to a little force them a little more because he said that, just because he said that he's going to do it? Do you think that he can do that? I'm talking about Bernanke.
Yeah, it's a question of, it goes back to this question of escape velocity, which is the point from which the economy will not fall. Because it's suddenly, the growth is accelerating.
The growth is accelerating. But the question is,
is it accelerating because the low rates are in place, and can the acceleration continue in the face of spiking rates? Right, and that's not clear. This is the first time we're asking this question now.
How can you even gauge that?
Well, I mean, and this goes back to the short term versus the long term. We will not know until 6 months down the line if the economy is at escape velocity until after the fact. But we can at least get a sense of what bets in the market are doing. And again, looking at home builders, financials, anything that is in domestic industrial sensitive, anything that's consumer sensitive, those stocks are actually not doing as well as the S&P the last 2-3 weeks, despite better economic reports. And there are times when, the saying goes, you sell the news. It's already been good. Maybe now we are to start to see a reversion of the good to maybe not as good.
Thank you so much, Michael. Thanks for coming and sharing this wonderful article and beyond. And even next week's report that you're going to write for Mark Faber, you shared everything with us. So we all know the future. Thank you again. Okay.